You know very well that God has made us in such a way that truth makes a peculiarly powerful impact on us when it comes to us in the context of story, event, real-life characters and incidents. It's a great argument for reading and preaching the narrative portions of Scripture, so too for reading Christian biography and encouraging others to read Christian biography. And in that regard, the Banner of Truth has put us massively in its debt through its republication of older Christian biographies, as well as its publication of some newer biographies. I want to say just a word or two about three of the older works. The Life of Robert Murray McShane, The Diary and Life of Andrew Bonar, and The Life of John Milne of Perth. They were all Scotsmen. They were all born in the early 1800s, and for a time they all ministered within a very small geographical area. John Milne was in Perth, Andrew Bonar was in the Perthshire village of Colais, and McShane was in Dundee. And they were part of a wider group of very remarkable young evangelical ministers of the Church of Scotland. This is the late 1830s, early 1840s. There were others, James Hamilton, a near neighbour in Abernight, Robert MacDonald, another near neighbour in Blairgowrie. Further afield, Alexander Somerville in Glasgow, Horatius Bonar down in Kelso. And in the midst of them all, that remarkable man, William Chalmers Burns. It was a wonderful time of awakening and revival in Scotland. And these young men, these three young men here, were at the forefront of that movement. They were marked by prayerfulness, by love for Christ, by a passion for the gospel. And if you haven't read these, let me warmly commend. This is a classic, McShane's biography. I think this was the very first biography of the Banner that I ever read. Had an immense influence on me. Andrew Bonar's Diary and Life, fragrant with Christ. John Milne of Perth, stir your heart just to see what God did through those men. And it will stir you to prayer that God will raise up men like those, and that those of us whom he has raised up, it would please to use in far greater ways than he has done hitherto. Well, let's hear the word of God. This is Psalm 23. Then afterwards, we're going to sing Psalm 23 as we find it in our Psalters. Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. And we give thanks to God for his word. Please take your psalm books and turn to Psalm 23. If we could have it to Crimond, please, whoever's presenting. Psalm 23, the Lord's my shepherd. We'll stand to sing.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Our great and gracious God, we thank you that we know you as the Lord our Shepherd. We thank you that that is what we know you in Christ Jesus our Lord, the Good Shepherd, who laid down his life for the sheep. And we think of him in the days of his flesh, seeing the crowd harassed and helpless, pitying them because they were like sheep without a shepherd. And our hearts likewise would go out to the people of our communities, of our land, of our world, who are in exactly the same position. We thank you, gracious God, for what you are doing in gathering men and women, boys and girls, into Christ's flock. We pray that what we hear this morning will stir our hearts to pray all the more earnestly that the Spirit would so work that those who are so lost, so needy, would come to have in Christ the Good Shepherd that we know him to be ourselves. Thank you for your servant who spoke to us yesterday, for the encouragement that it was to our souls to hear these things. We pray the Spirit would rest upon him as he comes and speaks to us today. Hear us, we pray. Bless and be with us. All we ask is for Jesus' sake. Amen.
Amen.
We are deeply grateful to Lindsay Brown for his ministry to us yesterday, and brother, come and speak to us again. We are thankful to God for you.
Thank you. Just a couple of brief words of introduction, if I may, gentlemen. First of all, yesterday, as I was talking about the growth and the advance of the cause of the gospel around the world, I wanted to share those things to encourage you, because it's hard going in the UK. And but sometimes it can actually depress people if they hear of great advances in other parts of the world and they're in a struggling situation. In God's goodness, the ministry he gave me was an itinerant ministry among students for the last 40 years. But I do want to say that, so I see the growth of the gospel in other parts of the world. But I do want to say, I deeply respect every one of you who's been working for many years in situations where there's little obvious growth and where you persevered maybe for several decades. So thank you for the encouragement such people are in ministry to those of us who are also in an itinerant ministry where we see the growth of the gospel as we're able to visit many different places. Secondly, two of the countries I mentioned where there's been the most spectacular growth the last 20 years are Iran and Mongolia. And it may interest you to know that I was reading the diaries of a missionary from the London Missionary Society from the 1880s, not too long ago, a man who spent 20 years in Mongolia, and he didn't see one single person come to Christ in 20 years. But at the end of his life, he wrote something in his journal or his diary, which I read, in which he said, "It hasn't pleased God to bring any Mongolians to living faith yet, but I'm praying that the day of fruitfulness will come, and I'm sure that in God's good time, it will do so." It started almost 100 years after that man went to heaven. And sometimes we can't see the subterranean work of the Holy Spirit. We just have to trust that he's at work and that he is hearing our prayers and seeing fit to root things in the soil through our ministry in which ways we can't see. Then Iran was the other country I mentioned, which is perhaps the fastest growing church in the world. Sam Yesnagar says now there are over 1 million Iranian evangelicals. But again, I read the diaries of a missionary in Iran, a British missionary some years ago. And he said at the end of years of ministry, "I don't think I've seen any fruit from my ministry. And I don't think I've done very much sowing. But I've cleared an awful lot of rubble away so somebody can come in after me." So some of you may be like that. Someone yesterday gave me a book by the great French theologian Pierre Courtial called A New Day of Small Beginnings. So I want to contrast what we looked at yesterday, which was the Spirit at work in overt and powerful ways at Pentecost and around the world, with a situation where there were small beginnings. And we go for that to the story of the familiar story of Paul in Mars Hill. And the theme of this morning, therefore, is Paul's ministry with the help of the Holy Spirit in this pagan, idolatrous context, in the hope that we can learn some principles that will be of help to us in our own ministry. I think this passage is particularly helpful for at least three reasons, which I'll mention in a moment. But there's a little photograph for you of Mars Hill, in case you're wondering where it was. And you can look at that now if you want while I read the passage from Acts 17, verse 16. "While Paul was waiting for them in Athens, he was greatly distressed to see that the city was full of idols. So he reasoned in the synagogue with the Jews and the God-fearing Greeks, as well as in the marketplace day by day with those who happened to be there. A group of Epicurean and Stoic philosophers began to dispute with him. Some of them asked, 'What is this babbler trying to say?' Others remarked, 'He seems to be advocating foreign gods.' They said this because Paul was preaching the good news about Jesus and the resurrection. Then they took him and brought him to a meeting of the Areopagus, where they said to him, 'May we know what this new teaching is that you're presenting? You're bringing some strange ideas to our ears, and we want to know what they mean.' All the Athenians and the foreigners who lived there spent their time doing nothing but talking about and listening to the latest ideas." Sounds like our culture with a fascination with the new, doesn't it? "Paul then stood up in the meeting of the Areopagus and said, 'Men of Athens, I see that in every way you are very religious. For as I walked around and looked carefully at your objects of worship, I even found an altar with this inscription, to an unknown God. Now, what you worship as something unknown, I'm going to proclaim to you. The God who made the world and everything in it is the Lord of heaven and earth, and does not live in temples built by hands. And he is not served by human hands as if he needed anything, because he himself gives all men life and breath and everything else. From one man he made every nation of men, that they should inhabit the whole earth, and he determined the times set for them and the exact places where they should live. God did this so that men would seek him and perhaps reach out for him and find him, though he's not far from each one of us. For in him we live and move and have our being. As some of your own poets have said, we are his offspring. Therefore, since we are God's offspring, we should not think that the divine being is like gold or silver or stone, an image made by man's design and skill. In the past, God overlooked such ignorance, but now he commands all men, all people everywhere to repent. For he set a day when he will judge the world with justice by the man he's appointed. He's given proof of this to all men by raising him from the dead. When they heard about the resurrection of the dead, some of them sneered, but others said, we want to hear you again on this subject. And at that, Paul left the council. A few men became followers of Paul and believed. Among them was Dionysius, a member of the Areopagus, also a woman named Damaris, and a number of others. Well, I think this passage is important for many reasons, but three I may mention briefly. One is for those who are working in major urban centres. It shows us a model, perhaps, of how to engage with people with the gospel in cities. And we're living in an increasingly urban world, of course, even if we're living in small market towns, as I am. Those small towns, because of mass media, are influenced by urbanisation. Paul travelled, of course, on his second and third missionary journeys to great cities of influence: Athens, intellectual centre; Corinth, the commercial centre; and Ephesus, the religious centre, where was found the Temple of Artemis, or Diana, one of the seven wonders of the world. And Paul's ministry is interesting in its difference to the style of Jesus, who seemed to spend most of his time visiting small villages and small towns in the Galilee region, not so much big cities, whereas Paul seems to have strategically targeted these major centres. Geographers these days talk about mega cities, that's a city of 1 million or more, and increasingly the world is becoming a world of mega cities and an urban world. In 850, there were four of these cities in the world. 1980, there were 225. Now there are 550 mega cities, with 60 cities more than 5 million in population. So the passage, because it focuses on Paul's ministry in the city, will have something to say for those of us who are working in that context. Secondly, it's useful for people working in a university context, because that's few of us, but essentially the nearest thing we have to a university in the New Testament is here in Athens. But thirdly, I think the passage is important because it shows us how Paul worked in a particularly difficult cultural context, which was resistant to the gospel and which has parallels with our own cultural context, where we're afflicted by the unholy trinity of secularism, hedonism, and perhaps the biggest challenge, pluralism, the notion that there's no one God or one way to God, but there's a plurality of the sources of truth, which cuts right across the Christian conviction about the uniqueness of Jesus Christ. Now, the Holy Spirit is not actually mentioned at all in this passage, as far as I can see, but his fingerprints are all over what Paul is doing here. And I suppose one of the questions we have to ask as we go through the passage is, as we look at Paul's style and message, did he fail? That's how some people have historically viewed Paul's approach in Athens, that perhaps he should have behaved in the same as Peter or elsewhere, and he might have been more fruitful. Because there's an absence of reference to biblical truth. He doesn't quote the Old Testament, although when he gives his discourse, it's full of biblical allusions. But he seems to quote from some of their secular pagan authorities. Well, what can we learn then? I'd like to suggest we break it down with three M's to make it easier for us all. First of all, Paul's motivation, then his methodology, then his message and its implications. First of all, Paul's motivation. In verse 16, we see that when he entered Athens, he was struck by the idolatry of the people. And he had what some people would call a paroxysm, which is rather like a seizure where you were taken up short, just like that. He was inwardly, the Jerusalem Bible says, he was inwardly revolted by the evidence that he saw of the worship of these false gods. And actually, the Greek text talks about Athens being under the influence of these many gods, of idolatry. In fact, some satirists in the first century said it was easier to find a god in Athens than it was to find a man. Another satirist said there are more gods in Athens than there are people. The city, the text says, was under its idols, smothered, swamped, oppressed. And Paul was inwardly revolted by what he saw. Now, that has an that gives us an indication of his motivation in his response. Now, we've heard many sermons about motivation for evangelism. We're motivated by the love of Christ constraining us. We're motivated by the terror of judgment to come, according to 2 Corinthians 5. We're motivated by experiencing the power of God's reconciling grace. But I'd like to suggest that what this passage highlights is that Paul probably here was motivated by something surprising, jealousy for the glory of God. Now, I say that very deliberately because I remember Derek on the first evening mentioned the Septuagint, the Greek translation of the Old Testament. There's only one other occasion in the scriptures where this phrase about a paroxysm or an overwhelming distress is mentioned. And it's in the Greek version of the Old Testament, the Septuagint, where Moses comes down from Sinai and the Jewish people have melted all the gold and they have a golden calf. And God's response, we're told in Exodus, is that he has a paroxysm. He is overwhelmingly distressed by the behavior of the Jews. And he says he's overwhelmingly distressed, quote, because I am jealous for my own glory. So by implication, if God was jealous for his glory when they engage in idolatry around the golden calf in Exodus, we can imply that similarly, Paul was jealous for God's glory in this passage. And jealousy is not always a sin. It's the resentment of an intrusion of someone into a relationship who shouldn't justifiably be there. And the reason that God is jealous in the Old Testament is that no other gods or idols should be worshipped, only him uniquely. Paul has the same experience here. And so we can understand that Paul is jealous for God's glory in this context. Let me try to illustrate it from the history of missions. There was a great missionary at the beginning of the 1800s who was a product of Cambridge University. He took the gospel to Iran. His name was Henry Martin. He was a brilliant mathematician. And he translated the New Testament into the Farsi language, the first translation. The most recent translation just occurred a couple of years ago. Well, Henry Martin never wrote a book, and he died at about 30, 31 years of age. But he did write lots of correspondence and letters to his fiancée, David Bentley Taylor, a great missionary of recent years, he's gone to heaven now, wrote a book about Henry Martin. And the book's entitled My Love Must Wait. Because in one of the letters to his fiancée, he says, I can't consummate our loving relationship. I have to complete the translation in the New Testament. So my love must wait to be consummated. And that's where David got the title for the book. But in the book, David Bentley Taylor recounts another letter which Henry Martin wrote to his fiancée. At that time in the early 1800s, there was a war between Russia and Iran, Iran being viewed as a Muslim nation and Russia as a Christian nation. And in one of the skirmishes, a lot of Russian soldiers were killed. Henry Martin recounts the story that an Islamic mullah came to see him and he said to him, last night I had a vision and in my vision, your Jesus fell at the feet of my Muhammad and pleaded with him for mercy for the lives of the Russian soldiers. Henry Martin then wrote these words to his fiancée. My soul was cut. I was cut to the soul by this blasphemy. I could not endure existence if Christ was not glorified. It would be hell for me if he was not glorified or if he was dishonored. For when he is insulted, I am wounded. Now, I suppose the question for us is, do the same responses arise in our hearts? Are we jealous for God's glory? If you like, burning and consumed with the desire to see his name glorified and honored. That's something about Paul's motivation in this text and Henry Martin's as a missionary. Secondly, let's look briefly at his methodology. Now, I know that in Reformed circles, as soon as you mention the word methodology, people kind of retreat because we're almost paranoid about techniques. But I think what we need to note here is that Paul's method or approach, maybe a better term, was driven by certain principles of engagement with the people whom he was trying to reach. And I'd like to highlight perhaps three or four principles which govern Paul's approach or methodology in this context, which may influence how we engage with people of other faiths or the other convictions. It's worth pointing out that in the text, there are four completely different words that explain how Paul engaged with these people. In verse 17, it says he reasoned with them. In verse 18, it says he was in dispute with them. In verse 18, he preached to them. And verse 19, so my Greek friends in Thessaloniki told me he dialogued with them, or they say today that word is used for people chatting. So Paul used four different approaches of engaging with them, which included preaching, but these other approaches too. Well, the key first point, I think, about Paul's methodology is that he went to where the people were and proclaimed the good news to them. In verse 17, the first part of the verse, it says that he went and engaged with the religious people in the synagogue. Michael Green, in his book, Evangelism in the Early Church, says this is often how Paul and the New Testament apostles worked. They worked from the center out, so from the religious people outwards, before engaging the pagans. The synagogue first. Secondly, in the second half of verse 17, it says that he engaged with the passers-by in the agora, or the marketplace. And then thirdly, the philosophers in the Areopagus. They mocked him and made fun of him and used an unusual Greek word in verse 18. They call him a spermologos or babbler. Now, the spermologos was a bird in the first century, a seed picker. And what they were saying of Paul was that he wasn't all that intelligent. He was just picking up ideas wherever he could find them and just meshing them together. And that's how he got his message. So they were trying to decry him and make fun of him. But nevertheless, he persisted. And I think what we see here is how he tried to engage with the people where they were. Now, this has implications for us because all through history, the church since the first century has always struggled to work out how do we relate to the world. The dominant view has been separation from the world. Come ye out from amongst them. A reaction against this has been assimilation, which often is manifested in worldliness, liberal theology, and so on. A third approach is that of engagement, which I would suggest is Paul's approach here, and a more biblical approach rooted in Jesus' own ministry. Separationism is the dominant approach in the history of the church, but John Stott said of that on one occasion, memorably, the calling, God's calling to the church is to be morally distinct without being socially segregated. And often we've confused the two and thought we can only retain our moral distinctiveness if we cut ourselves off, forgetting that in John 17, Jesus said, I have sent him into the world as you sent me in the world, but not of the world. So our model is to follow the model of Jesus. Now, one evangelist, I think rather crudely and sometimes maybe a little bit harshly, referred to some of us in this group of the extreme separationists as in danger of what he called rabbit hole Christianity, by which he meant you've seen a rabbit down in its burrow And it looks up to see if there are any enemies around. If there's nothing, he goes out and gets his lettuce, comes back quickly without having any contact at all with the wildlife around. And this evangelist, maybe a shade harshly, was implying that some of us are like that as we engage in our church activities. We come out of our houses in the morning, carrying our Bibles, see if the way is clear, go along to church worship, and then retreat as quickly as possible so that we perhaps are not infected by the world. That may be a little bit harsh of some folks, but it is important for us to reflect on separationism, and if it sometimes leads us to cutting ourselves off from the world unnecessarily. The second one is a reaction, assimilation. Well, that's led, as I said, to liberal theology and other excesses, and we should have no track with that. But the focus on engagement, I think, has its roots theologically in the incarnation of Jesus. That's where it comes from. The fact that Jesus came down from heaven and dwelt amongst us without losing any of his uniqueness and his purity. And what it says of Jesus is that as he was amongst us, he was the friend of sinners. And I suppose we can tell if we're too separationist by asking ourselves, do I have any friends who are sinners? That's the challenge for some of us, particularly in Christian ministry. Can we reflect or name anyone who is a friend of ours who's not yet in the kingdom? And so we see here Paul engaging with the people where they are. And I suppose the question for us to ask ourselves today is, where is our Mars Hill? Where is our Areopagus? And it may be different for different people. For some people, it may be, I asked my son where his Areopagus when he was studying in Edinburgh University. He said, well, that's easy, Dad. It's the coffee shop. That's where everything happens. I remember bringing some Serbian students to the UK to observe mission weeks. As I mentioned, I'm working with about 70 evangelists around Europe. And we do about 200, these mission weeks in about 200 universities every year. We've had them in about 170 European cities already this year. January to March, April is the strongest period. And often we bring people from other countries, continental Europe, to observe the UK mission weeks here. I remember bringing some Serbs, and in Britain they have lunch bars, as they call them, where you have sandwiches and a drink and then a short talk of 20 minutes and a dialogue. And I said to the Serbs, do you think this would work in Serbia? They said, no, you eat your food too fast in Britain. We can't eat food that fast. We need time to dialogue. Everything is done, they said, in the coffee shop. So marriage proposals occur there, business deals. So what they decided to do, because they couldn't get rooms in the university, was they hired coffee shops on top of bookshops very close to the university for 3-4 hours and promised to buy a certain number of drinks in exchange for having free use of the coffee shop, where they could have some music, they could present the gospel and sit and dialogue together. Another person I saw that do this was one of the great missionaries of the 20th century. I don't know if you've read his autobiography. His name was Charles Marsh. He's from a Brethren background. He even frightened George Vuer of OM. When George introduced me to him many years ago, he said, this guy frightens me. He's on the edge of extremism. And he said that because Charles Marsh was called of God to go to Algeria. And he said to his wife, look, we know we're going to Algeria. That's where God's called us. So let's not bother with the honeymoon. Let's just go straight there the day after, which they did. Not something to be followed. But he spent 40 years in ministry in North Africa, and he's written about it in the book Streams in the Desert and Is Anything Too Hard for God? And his particular approach, he wrote one of the best books I've ever read on reaching Muslims. I memorized chapters from it. It's so effective, called Share Your Faith with the Muslim, published by Moody Press. It's brilliant. And these were illustrations of how he dialogued with Muslims in Algeria in the coffee shops. He would go there each day and just sit and talk with people and engage them in these dialogues that he had developed himself. And it's very interesting. On one occasion, he said somebody came up to him, put a knife in his back and say there's only one God, his name is Allah and his prophet is Muhammad. And Charles Marsh said, you know I can't deny my Lord. You must do whatever you want. And the man put his knife down. He said, well, I knew you wouldn't, but I thought I'd try anyway. Anyway, what is interesting in the last 20 years, you know, Charles Marsh worked for 40 years, the first 20 years, no converts at all. then 2 years, maybe 15 to 20, all killed by their families. So after 22 years, almost nothing lasting. The last 20, he saw maybe 150 people profess faith in Christ. You know where the church is growing fastest in Algeria today? He died about 20 years ago. In many of the areas, he was reaching out to people in coffee shops. But he didn't see it, just like we may not. So there's an illustration of engagement with people where we are. And I suppose the question we have to ask ourselves is, where are the places where we can engage with people in our cultural context? I decided a few years ago that one of the places near where I live is the Hay Festival, the Hay Literature Festival. It's very liberal, but I go there every year just to dialogue with some of the speakers. And I have had wonderful opportunities to go and hear an editor of the Times who said he was an atheist publicly, so I took him on publicly and challenged him. Then someone who was the front man for a major cultural program on television. I can't say his name because this has been recorded, but he came from a fundamentalist background, so he said in his talk, so I went and talked with him afterwards and told him it was time to come back to his roots and trust the God of the Bible, and we had a very interesting conversation. Then with someone else last year who was talking about grieving and facing up to death, and I asked him publicly in front of the 800 people, well, you haven't mentioned the New Testament teaching about the resurrection of Jesus Christ and the hope of Christians, shouldn't you go there? I said that because I knew the guy's father was a canon in the Anglican Church, a liberal guy who had lost it. And so I think all of us, therefore, have to look for opportunities and situations where we can go to where people are in a more deliberate way, whatever that might be. Secondly, I think the passage teaches us that Paul aroused their curiosity when he went to meet with them in verses 18 to 21. He clearly was asking them questions as they were asking him, may we know what this new teaching is that you are presenting? You're bringing some strange ideas to our ears, and we want to know what they mean. Clearly, Paul had done a lot of looking, a lot of thinking, a lot of discussing, a lot of reading. So he developed the art of asking provocative questions. Someone has written a book about Jesus' style in evangelism called Questioning Evangelism. And it's intriguing when you read through the Gospels, just list how many questions Jesus asked of people. And sometimes when they gave a question in response, he didn't give an answer. He only gave them a second question to mull over. And it was Francis Schaeffer of La Brie who particularly emphasized the art of developing the approach of asking questions of people. In my work in the student world, it's quite common to have dialogue meetings with students. And some years ago, my wife she used to travel around British universities speaking to radical feminist groups. They're much more diverse and diffuse these days. But on one occasion, there were about 70 women in this meeting. And after she'd given a talk on the way Jesus had treated women in the Gospels as being special and unique with its implications for following him, one of the young women got up and in the question time and she launched into a diatribe of 10 minutes attacking the church and attacking Jesus for just having women sitting at his feet and so on. Exhausted after 10 minutes, she drew a breath and my wife said, can I ask you a question? If there was a God who is there, what would you like him to do to show you that he's concerned for you? And then this young woman thought for a moment and she said, if there's a God in heaven, he'd better come down from that throne of his, come and live in this world that he supposedly created and sort out the mess that we're in. And then she said, oh no, that's what Jesus did, isn't it? So it shows how questions are very important in the way that we dialogue with people. Paul asked provocative questions, and he focused on issues that were of interest to them. It's interesting here, he quotes two of their philosophers, Aratus, who said, we're all God's offspring, Epimenides also. He starts his presentation by working with a piece of sculpture that was a piece of idolatry. And I'm amazed how gracious he was. You see, the Welsh approach would be very different. A Welsh evangelist wants to knock those people out, which is why we can't get engaged in dialogue with folks in these situations because we get over passionate. What amazes me about Paul is that he was provoked, revolted internally by the idolatry, but he didn't say, as I probably would, "You stupid idiots, don't you realize how idolatrous you are?" He said, "Men of Athens, I observe you're very religious." It's an astonishing, humble approach to these folks in dialogue as he engages with them. And so I suppose one of the things that we need to do is to arouse curiosity by engaging in dialogue and raising questions. I love the quotation of John Calvin. I've not heard anybody else pick this one up, where Calvin said, in this respect, quoting, "Why quote Aratus and Epimenides?" Calvin said, "I will take honey even if I find it in the lion's mouth." In other words, all truth is God's truth. He's not saying I agree with everything these guys say. But what he's doing is he's extracting some statements they're making which have truth content to them, and he builds on that. So he's starting with their poets and also with their artwork. And that raises the question for us about how we can engage with and build with people by maybe reading around some contemporary poetry or book reviews or film reviews. I remember when I was in La Brie many years ago in Switzerland, Francis Schaeffer came into this room on Saturday night. He just sat on this desk by the fireplace and he said, "Right, what's the first question?" No sermon. The students started throwing questions at him like hand grenades. And he was just brilliant at answering the questions. And somebody said to him, "You're referring to a lot of literature here and contemporary film and poetry and theatre. How do you find time to read it all or go and see it?" And I'll never forget what he said. He said, "I don't. I read the reviews every Saturday. And if something is worth going to see and is helpful for the purpose of evangelism, I may go and see it, or I may read it." But he said, "The reviews are only about 8 pages long. I've done it every Saturday since I heard that 35 years ago. Every Saturday you have the Culture magazine of the Times, for example. It's about 8 pages. And it has the new films. It has what's on in the theatre. It has literature. And that's where I would get most of my evangelistic quotations from in terms of keeping up with students, and also quotes from pop records, who are the Aratus and Epimenides of our day. They are the poets and the influencers of our day." And what we see here is how Paul starts his argument by taking the ideas of these people to disarm them and engage with them and build bridges and move on from there to engage with them. Let me mention one illustration I saw of this with. I don't want to go on about quotations from Martin Lloyd-Jones, but this was a great illustration, I think. Many years ago, I think it was about 40 years ago, I went to hear him preach in the Heath Church in Cardiff, and he was preaching on Genesis chapter 3. And in those days, it was the late 60s, early 70s, there was all this stuff about the age of Aquarius and the search for utopia and so on. And Lloyd-Jones started off the first 15 minutes of his talk, he didn't speak about scripture at all. He talked about man's search for utopia across history. And now it was a very ordinary population with not many university types there. And he knew that the people in the congregation didn't know the names of all these people, so he didn't parade them. I knew he was quoting from Aristotle and Plato and Spinoza and so on, because I was studying political theory in university. But most people wouldn't be aware of those names. What he did was he traced the history of political thought as men and women across the centuries have tried to get back to utopia or get back to the garden. He even got up to the birth of the United Nations, bringing all the nations of the world together and so on within the first 15 minutes. And then at the end of the 15 minutes, he said, "It's been an amazing and a wonderful attempt, but it's failed. Let me tell you how to get back to the garden." Then he preached the gospel. Very few people who followed Lloyd-Jones' style of preaching picked up on those first 15 minutes. Because what he was often doing was he was cutting, 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 undercutting the prevailing worldview, showing its weakness. And that particular night, we weren't married, but my wife was there with a Greek Cypriot philosophy student. And she sat there getting increasingly angry all the way through.
because he was undermining her worldview all the time. Then after 15 minutes, open it up and hear the gospel. It was a brilliant illustration of what I would call persuasive evangelism, the Pauline approach here. This is an illustration of arousing their curiosity. Once again, when I was in Wrexham, in Cartrevle College, not the epicenter of academic life, but I remember there was a small group of students there in the first week of the university. They did a questionnaire around the campus, and they just asked people what their top questions were. And they promised that they would refashion the Christian Union program that term by just dealing with the top 10 questions. And the number of unbelievers who came up went up by 10 times as a result of them addressing their questions, which related to, can you trust the New Testament? What about the issue of suffering? And so on. Then next, Paul spoke positively and not negatively. Well, I've touched on that. Just to say, and built bridges. Just to say here, John Lennox is one of the masters of doing this. And some of you have probably seen him on DVD or YouTube or whatever. And John used to teach in Cardiff University. He's in Oxford now. And involved in lots of dialogues with hostile atheists, particularly from a scientific background around the world. He told me he was invited. He speaks, he's part of the network that I'm involved in. And he went to Australia to be involved in a debate with a very famous philosopher called Peter Singer, probably the best known in Australia. And Peter Singer's a difficult man who is in favor of putting to death all those who are handicapped. I mean, he's got some really extreme views. Anyway, at the beginning of the debate in the Sydney Opera House, John Lennox got up and he said, I'd like to tell you that I've read all of Peter Singer's books, and I want to introduce you to two of them which I found helpful. People were shocked. They were the less extreme ones. And then he proceeded to show where he disagreed with Peter Singer, attacking his strongest argument, which is typical of Lennox. Afterwards, Peter Singer asked John if he could see him privately behind the stage. And he said, John, I want to thank you for this evening, for the way that you introduced me. He said, I've never met a Christian who's ever been so kind to me. I want to thank you, and as a result, I want to invite you as my special guest to a presentation I'm giving tomorrow evening. Even a hardened person in that context responded to that spirit of generosity and bridge building. Then he reasoned with them, explaining and giving evidence. At the beginning of chapter 17, you see Paul reasoning from the scriptures in verses 2 and 4. Verse 17, we see it in the passage, he reasons. Verse 18, verse 4, it talks about reasoning. Verse 19, verse 80, reasons. Then in the Hall of Tyrannus, he's reasoning also. The Bible doesn't contrast faith and reason. It contrasts faith and sight. And if we're not careful, we fall into the trap of many unbelievers who say to us, like Richard Dawkins, believing that faith is believing something for which you know there is no evidence. Or as one evangelist said, ignore the mind and strike for the heart. Faith is not blind optimism. It's trusting in the evidences of God's hand at work through history, particularly the evidence for the resurrection. That's why Michael Green said to me the night before he died, I am confident that I'm going to raise with Christ because I've studied this all my life, and my hope of resurrection is based on the solid evidence of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. As John Stott said, we must not pander to people's intellectual curiosity, but we must give them reasons for believing. That's why Paul with Agrippa. Agrippa says, I'm almost persuaded. Paul says, you know that what I'm saying to you is both true and reasonable. In fact, Paul was saying there are evidences for the fulfillment of prophecy in Jesus' life, for his claims for deity, for his resurrection. So we argue reasons for the faith, the trustworthiness of the faith, for two reasons: because we're made in God's image as reasoning beings, and because the Holy Spirit is the Spirit of truth who leads us into all truth. That's why Francis Schaeffer said on one occasion, the biblical revelation gives us sufficient in order to believe. It doesn't give us exhaustive answers to all the questions we give, but it gives us the best answers.
particularly to the question of suffering. On this, it's interesting that Tim Keller, when he was invited to speak in the anniversary of 9/11 in New York, he was given 7 minutes. And he thought, what could I say to these folks who are remembering loved ones who are lost? And he quoted some secular philosophers, and he said, I know that you're hurting today, but please, there's no grounds for blaming God for what happened here. In fact, if you take God out of the picture, you still have to deal with the problem of suffering. And you have to ask yourself whether your worldview has any better answer than the biblical worldview's answer to the problem of suffering. It's a real showstopper when you ask a question like that. Well, enough on Paul's methodology. Briefly on his message. Some people think the sermon was a failure. But what Paul later reasoned in Corinth was that he was opposed to the wonder of the wisdom of the world, not the doctrine of God, which he highlights here in this passage. And in quick summary, in verses 24 to 31, Paul highlights the same three things that Peter highlights in his sermon, and as Michael Green argues in his brilliant book, his doctoral thesis, Evangelism in the Early Church, wherever you start from, in any of the apostolic sermons in Acts, they all end with the same three things. So whether you start in Acts chapter 2, where Paul is quoting a lot of Old Testament references to the coming of Christ, or whether you start as Paul did here, by quoting pagan poets and philosophers and pointing to a piece of sculpture, both men say the same three things at the end. Guess what they are? One, there's only one God who created us, and we are accountable to him. Secondly, this God raised Jesus from the dead. You can't have a death. You can't have a resurrection without death, of course. Thirdly, therefore you must repent or face judgment. It's in every apostolic sermon. And it amazes me that there's not more preaching on the resurrection. I cannot understand why we preach the cross without the resurrection. It's the two sides of the same message. We undercut our message. It's almost as if we missed out 1 Corinthians 15, where Paul talks about the centrality of the resurrection. We should preach the cross when we preach the resurrection, and the resurrection when we preach the cross, because no other faith has this emphasis on the resurrection through their founder and leader, as in the person of Jesus. Here are these three things in the text here. First of all, the nature and character of God. In verse 24, he says he's the creator of the universe. He cannot be contained or dwell in buildings. Secondly, in verse 25, he's the sustainer of life. He gives us life. He's not dependent upon us. He does not serve us. He's the ruler of the nations. This is where the quotation from Aratus comes in later. We can't localize him. He's the father of human beings. He's the judge of the world. And therefore, he says to his hearers, therefore, God calls you, you must repent now. Let's look at that verse 30 and 31. God commands all people everywhere to repent. In other words, this is not a soft soaping message. He started where they are, but by the time he's into communicating the full biblical revelation as to who God has revealed himself as, in distinction to their fallible notions of who God was, when he's clarified the character and the person of God in the scriptures, then he goes on to explain about the resurrection and God commanding people in the light of this evidence to repent and trust the Christ whom he has risen from the dead. So those three elements are in Paul's message: the nature of God, the resurrection of Jesus, the certainty of judgment. And it would be an interesting Bible study to do. I believe Michael Green is correct in saying they're in every apostolic sermon in Acts. So the three things that we observe from Paul's approach here are, first of all, the depth and the power of his motivation. It may be that we are not so powerfully motivated because we don't see as Paul sees. We don't look as Paul looked. We don't think as Paul thought. We don't reflect as Paul did. We don't go out into the society with our eyes open and see the awful idolatry which provokes or should provoke us to be jealous for God's glory. And it may be one of the things that we need to do is to ask the Lord, please, Lord, by your Holy Spirit, fill me with a fresh sense of appropriate jealousy for your glory. Secondly, notice the versatility of his approaches or his methods, going to where people were, engaging them where they were at, whether it was coffee shops
or elsewhere. We've just had something in our church in Monmouth. We had problems there over 20 years ago, just before I moved there, and the church fell down was reduced to 30 people. A young pastor came, and God's used him to build the church up to about 18, 90 people. And it took us 20 years before we could have a mission again. We were so dysfunctional, and people had lost confidence. Then in the last couple of months, we had this, I thought was a very helpful idea. The pastor said, now we're going to scrap midweek meetings for 6 weeks, and we'll have instead one midweek evangelistic meeting, either in the coffee shop downtown or in the church. We decided to segment the society of the town in Monmouth and ask, what are the particular groups here? There's an art group. So we had someone to give a talk, and it was World Women's Week. So a woman gave a talk, an illustrated talk on From Eve to Mary Magdalene, Is There Any Good News for Women? Huge turnout in the town. Then there were articles on decluttering in the newspapers. So we invited a decluttering expert to come and speak, and we linked it all up with Sunday morning as a means of bringing people from the neutral territory to the Sunday morning worship. So after the talk on Mary Magdalene, we had a talk on Sunday morning of Jesus encountering the woman of Samaria. And all the Sunday sermons were Jesus' encounters with people. After we had the one on decluttering, we had a talk on Sunday morning on a spiritual spring clean in the life of an individual, Nicodemus. And so another one was a cancer expert from Oxford speaking on suffering. We couldn't get everybody in the church. There was an overflow out onto the streets. And then on Sunday morning, a talk from a local preacher on suffering and the hope of heaven. Andrew Davis, a well-known Welsh preacher, came and spoke on spiritual spring clean, the one after decluttering. And afterwards, I was talking with him, and he said, I've been coming to this church for many years. What's happening here? Never seen so many people here. And you could see the confidence in the believers rising, so much so many said, we wish it wouldn't stop. We'd like to carry on. We found an approach which fitted our culture. Was versatile. We thought about having an intensive week like students do, but we decided it's too much for the church. It would exhaust them. So spread it out over 5 or 6 weeks. And next year we'll do the same thing under the theme of Passion for Life, with a mixture of testimonies and midweek events related to Sunday morning. And you can see how the life of many believers in the church has been renewed, as well as many people signing up for beginners groups and searchers groups as a consequence. And the third dimension of Paul is the comprehensiveness of his message. Notice how he starts with God as creator, moves on to him as the sustainer of life, the ruler, the father, the judge. Maybe sometimes our message is insufficiently comprehensive. Creation, cross, resurrection, consummation. It's all there in Paul's address to these people who had no biblical background at all. Maybe we undersell the message. Well, I need to close there, because what is interesting at the same time is, whereas in Pentecost there were several thousand who believed, there were just a few here. Some sneered, we're told in verse 32. Some said, well, let's hear you again on this subject. And a few became followers, like Dionysius, Damaris, and others. Had Paul failed? No, I think the ground was just different, as it is for some of us. And we should not allow ourselves to fall into the slough of despond if we're in situations where there's not an immediate response. So before I close, I want to give you two final illustrations of this. Ajit Fernando told me this story at the Welsh Leadership Forum last September. He said there was a cross-cultural missionary who went to a South Sea island in the Pacific and served there for 40 years. Amongst headhunters, amongst the tribal people. And not one person was converted in 40 years. He was a very godly brother. He worked for all that time with no response. After he died, the same mission agency sent a young missionary in. And within 2 years, there was a revival with literally thousands of people turning to Christ. Now, the young missionary knew it was nothing to do with him, because he couldn't even speak the language. So he went to see the chief of the tribe. And he said, sir, you had a very godly Christian missionary here, served you for 40 years, and no one responded to his message. But since I've come here, revival has broken out, and you and many others have come to trust in Christ. Can you explain why? He said, oh, it's simple. When that great and godly missionary was here for 40 years, he told us that believers do not need to fear death, that there's the hope of heaven on the other side, and we can look forward to it, not with trepidation, but joy. So we waited to see if it was true. And then when he died, and he died joyfully, we knew it was true, so we believed. In the same way, brothers, people are watching you to see if it's true. I always remember my parents' conversion. I was the first believer, as far as I can tell, ever in my family. And my parents were converted 20 years after me. And it was the day after my only daughter died. My father asked to see me. And he said, your mother and I have arranged to be baptized. In a month's time, we'd like to speak at the service. I said, Dad, you have to become a Christian first. He said, oh, I know that. And I said, why are you telling me today? He said, well, you can't fake joy in the midst of adversity, son. And I've known a lot of guys in business who said they were Christians and they were fakes. But he said, you can't fake it when you're in pain. And I can see you have hope because of the gospel. Your mother and I don't have, and we want it. And I said, well, why is it taking you so long? I've been a Christian for 20 years. He said, oh, didn't you know? I've been watching you every day. And other people in our communities are too, where some of you are pastors for a long time. And you're thinking, oh, why is it so slow? In small towns, they're watching you. It's like in Monmouth. And you can lose a reputation in days, but frankly, brothers, it takes decades to build it. And you may see the fruit in your ministry, some of it, but a lot of it may come afterwards. And that brings me to my last story of encouragement. We've heard of other great missionaries this morning, but Adoniram Judson is one of my heroes, the Baptist missionary from Boston, who went out to India, couldn't get in, and ended up in Myanmar, or present-day Burma, in 1812 with his wife, Anne. He served there for 38 years. His wife died, and he married the widow of another missionary, which was quite common in those days. And some people rather crudely said, oh, well, you lose one wife, you can have another. Apparently, he went to his wife's grave every day for a year. He just wept and said, Lord, I can't carry on. I'm finished. You give me a wonderful wife, and she's taken. How can I continue on? Anyway, he refound his equilibrium eventually. They lost 7 children. He served for 38 years. Sometimes he was hung upside down. He was often beaten by the authorities. There were very few conversions, maybe 12 of whom half of them dropped out. And in 1850, he contracted some lung disease. They took him out at sea to give him some sea air. He died at sea and they just dropped his body over the side, not even a grave after 38 years of ministry. But he had just completed the translation of the Bible into the Burmese language. 150 years later, a friend of mine went to Burma, or Myanmar, for the 150th anniversary of the translation of the Bible into the Burmese language. And as you do when you go to other countries, you look at the beginning to see, I've got a Gideon's New Testament here, can I understand any of the words there? And there was in small print the phrase, translated by Rev. A. Judson. So my friend Paul, it was a big conference, turned to the translator next to him, whose name was Matthew. He said, Matthew, do you know anything about this man? And the translator started to weep. He said, oh, I know him. He said, everybody in Burma knows him. We know how he loved us. We know how he suffered for us, how he was tortured. And we know how he died and was just dropped over the side of the boat. And there weren't even small groups in the country, and certainly no church as a result of his ministry. But he left the scriptures. He said when he died, there were perhaps no more than 10 believers. But today, we're 600,000. And every single one of us traces our spiritual heritage to one man, Adoniram Judson. And he never saw it. And brothers, neither will you or I. One of the best things about getting older is that we can see the hand of God over 40 years, but it's only the tip of the iceberg. So we should not give up, persevere and continue on, trust that God is doing his work by the Holy Spirit, and that in due course, the fruit will be evident. So I leave with you one of my very favorite verses in the scriptures in that respect. 1 Corinthians 15:58. After the long
Discourse on the Resurrection. Therefore, my dear brothers, stand firm, especially those of you in difficult situations, with small churches where you're struggling and you're wanting more of a breakthrough and wondering, why can't it be like Pentecost rather than Mars Hill? And even Mars Hill might be more fruitful than how I'm feeling at the moment. Therefore, my dear brothers, stand firm. Let nothing move you. Always give yourselves fully to the work of the Lord, because you know that your labor in the Lord, because it's in the Lord, will not be in vain. Let's pray. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for the models of Peter and Paul and how your Holy Spirit was gracious to speak through them. Forgive us if we become obsessed by large numbers. We do delight that the church is advancing around the world, and we thank you for these eruptions of the work of your Spirit and the growth and the advance of the gospel. It does encourage us. Forgive us, however, if we compare ourselves, if we become downcast because the work is slow in some of our situations. Please strengthen us afresh, we pray, Heavenly Father. Give us a fresh jealousy for Christ's glory. Help us to be versatile and fresh and creative in engaging with people where they are, following Jesus' incarnational model. And then help us to be faithful to the comprehensiveness of the biblical message. And all living God of heaven, fill us with a steadfast spirit and joy in service, love for you and the gospel, and for the people you've given us to serve. And grant, O Father, that there may be either small or larger eruptions in our lifetimes, represented in the Christian communities and churches of all those who are here. And we promise that as we see that happen, we will give the glory to you and to you alone. Amen.
Please take the Grey Psalms and Hymns book and turn to number 40. Facing a task unfinished that drives us to our knees, a need that undiminished rebukes our slothful ease, we who rejoice to know thee renew before thy throne the solemn pledge we owe thee to go and make thee known. Number 40.
We will rejoice to
We are going to break for tea and coffee, coming back 10 past 11 or so for an 11:15 start. Look forward to our brother Ted Donnelly's ministry to us again. I've been asked to encourage you when you take your coffee and tea to take a walk down the corridor and look at some of the exhibitions. We haven't been doing that very much, apparently. So please take the opportunity to do that during the next 45 minutes. Thank you.